Does ZFS kill your drives in Proxmox? One possible issue I've heard about with ZFS online and Proxmox and other hypervisors is that it can cause early death of SSDs as they can handle only so many write cycles, and ZFS causes additional writes compared to other file systems like ext4. So in this video, I set up a test bench, put a lot of SSDs in, and configured them all in different ways to see if write amplification happens, how big of an issue it is, and which ways it could be mitigated in. So let's dive into the tests I ran and the results I got. So first of all, with my initial tests, I took some of these Sun F40 drives I have laying around. Internally, these drives are essentially 4 100 GB SSDs, giving me a total of 20 drives on one system that are roughly equivalent to mess around with. I set them up with every reasonable standard configuration, as well as a lot of different ZFS configurations of RAID. So I had a single ext4, a single XFS, an LVM configuration, single ZFS, and then mirrored ZFS, RAID 5 ZFS, RAID 6 ZFS. In order to write equivalent data to all of these disks, I made a VM, gave it an equivalent sized virtual disk on all of the different storage types, and then I had a mirror using ZFS in the VM so that when I wrote data to a file, it was being written to all the different storage types equivalently. And looking inside the VM and the amount of writes it was doing, and it did confirm my testing was working correctly, and it was writing equivalent data to all of the different storage types. I then used a little script to report how much data was actually being written to each of the physical disks, and I made a little plot here that shows the cumulative writes after my different tests, and can see that ZFS is really standing out as writing significantly more data than ext4, XFS, and LVM, all of my single drive testing. So it definitely looks like ZFS has a possibility for write amplification as I saw in this test, and it is certainly worth looking into some more and seeing maybe what's causing that write amplification. But before I wanted to test write amplification, I also took a look at my ZFS RAID configurations to see if that was affecting write amplification. And in a summary, it wasn't. For example, if I had a terabyte of data written to my single ZFS drive, in my mirror I had essentially a 1 terabyte written to each of the drives within 1% of the single drive configuration. In a parity configuration, I'd take the total amount of data written, so 500 gigabytes, spread it across the two drives of data essentially, and then have a parity drive do it. So in a 3-drive RAID Z1, I effectively have 2 drives worth of parity data, 2 drives worth of data, and 1 drive worth of parity. Each of the data drives and parity drives all got 500 gigabytes, and so on for RAID 6 and also 4-disk RAID 5 configurations. So it looks like setting up RAID and ZFS does not result in any extra wear leveling or write amplification compared to a single disk ZFS configuration. But that still leaves me with the question of what is causing this ZFS write amplification. So for my second round of testing, I had a single ext4 as a control suspect, and I had a variety of different ZFS disks to see what configurations would matter. Before this point, all of my ZFS configurations were using the defaults in Proxmox. So I'd go in the web interface and I'd make a new ZFS storage disk and leave all the defaults except the disk I wanted to use and the RAID configuration. But now I tried playing with about everything I could think of that would possibly change the amount of write amplification. So I tried turning off compression, turning off A time, setting different ashift values, setting different record sizes, turning off sync and setting up a log drive, and more. And here's the quick little plot of everything. ext4 was pretty low in its total amount of writes, and on the values that stand out and seem to be significantly different than the other tests are the ones that have different sync settings. So it looks like the ones that have sync disabled and have a log device, and the other ones that stand out significantly are the ones with different ashift values. So let's look more into those parameters and how they might affect write amplification. Let's first take a look at synchronous writes to try to figure out why there's a difference in write amplification between ZFS, ext4, and disabling sync in ZFS. A synchronous write is where a program tells the system to write that data to disk securely. With many different drives, there's a small amount of volatile memory that data in flight will be stored in for a short period before being written to the non-volatile part of the drive. Oftentimes, drives will write data and then continue making sure it's permanently on the non-volatile storage after your program continues to run things faster. But if in case of a power outage during that very short period of time, that data won't be on disk and can cause problems. So with a synchronous write, you tell the drive to actually write it on the non-volatile storage, make sure it's written safely, and then the program can continue and know that it's done. This can take a lot longer depending on the exact drive model used, but some programs take advantage of that, and I see it frequently in VMs. From what I understand, in a more traditional file system like ext4, it just writes the data the normal way onto its normal thing, as well as updating its journal, and then once it writes the data, it sends that sync command to the drive, it writes it securely, and then once the drive says it's securely done its sync command, it comes back to the program and says, I'm all done writing the data, and it's securely on disk. ZFS, on the other hand, in its normal asynchronous mode, has a rotating log of all the different write operations that's going on that your program might be making, and then what needs to get written to disk and RAID, and then deletes it once it's actually securely on disk. But for its synchronous operation, it writes that log to disk and then takes its time to write it all the way to the disk securely a second time. And this means if you're doing a sync write using ZFS on a single disk, it's effectively writing the log to the disk so that it knows it's done securely, and then a little bit later it's writing the actual data to its normal data locations in ZFS on the rest of the drive. And this means you're effectively writing data twice to the drive with ZFS in synchronous modes. If you want to avoid doing this, you can get another disk in your system to work as a S-log or as a log device in ZFS. And that way it effectively takes that log, writes it to a different drive, so then those writes are done once on the S-log drive, once on the log drive, and then once like normal on the actual data drive itself. This means your data drive gets the normal amount of writes, but then you'll need to have extra writes done to your data drive. The next way to avoid this problem is to just not do sync writes. You can either configure your VM's cache settings to not do synchronous writes on it, or you can just tell ZFS sync equals disabled and it'll never do its sync write operation. The disadvantage with this is if you lose power or crash during one of these periods, your program may think it's written data safely to disk and it's securely on there, but it isn't securely on there, and that can cause weird problems. While disabling sync might be a good idea if you want to speed things up in a test environment, in a production environment, especially for things like database servers where they depend on writes being done securely to disk, you probably want to avoid just setting sync to disabled and either giving those heavier duty drives or a separate sync drive if you are using ZFS. The next setting I found in ZFS that had a significant difference when it comes to write amplification is the ashift setting. Ashift in ZFS affects ZFS's internal minimum block size it works with. This value is 2 to the power of your ashift setting, so if ashift was set to 9, for example, that would be 2 to the power of 9 or 512. 12 is 4K or 4096, and 13 is 8192 or 8K. This value can be set when creating a new pool by using the ashift parameter like this, or if you're setting up in Proxmox in the web interface, it's this value here, which appears to be set to 12 no matter what drives are being used. And what drives are being used seems to matter a lot here, as there's multiple types of drives on their internal block size, and this plays around with the ashift value used in ZFS to affect write amplification. So your results may vary and run your own tests, but from what I see with multiple of these drives that I used, is this is a 512-bit native drive, but it's an emulated to appear as 4K, and this one appears to the system as 8K, but it's 512-byte logical on the drives. And from what I see is going on here, ZFS by default is setting its minimum ashift to 12 or 4K, so that means anytime you do a write, it's writing at least 4K of data to the drive, which means it's writing at least 8 of those 512-byte blocks on the drive. And now the issue seems to come from if you're writing a super small amount of data, that means you're now effectively writing multiple blocks more than you'd have to, causing write amplification. Now typically it's recommended to leave the value at 12, as that's a kind of better value, especially when working with large amounts, large data. But it seems like oftentimes with these virtual disk images, you're working with these smaller block sizes and setting it to 9 can help. Now, issues can also occur from setting the value too low, which can cause poor performance as well as more write issues, because if you set the value to example for as 9 on a drive that has a sector size of 4096 on some newer 4K native drives, that means when you write one bit to ZFS, now it has to read the rest of the data, modify it, and then write the whole new 4K chunk to the drive, which causes a big performance hit. Unfortunately, because there's a lot of different drives, like my weird old 8K Sun F40 drives, kind of these consumer grade SATA drives, and NVMe drives that are getting more and more common in new systems now, you have to check out your exact drives and see what would work best. I'd start with the default 12 and kind of see how that works for you. Check out /sys/block/your device name/Q, and you can check out the logical block size, so likely what's actually the device using, and then the physical block size that it shows to the system. And if those are different, that's when you might want to change your values. In my other different settings I tried playing around with, like the block size in ZFS, turning off A time, and other settings, there didn't seem to be a significant difference that affects my results. So while they may have some effect to write amplification, so like A time likely writes a little bit more data as it writes access time every time you touch a file to the system, it wasn't a significant difference that I noticed a big change. So then what I did with knowing some of these changes, like turning off sync or putting it on a separate log device and making sure ashift is set right for your devices, I took two SSDs and just did a comparison of ZFS and EXT4 with those new settings, and lo and behold, the write amplification was basically gone, and the writes on those two drives were pretty close, showing that tuning those two parameters correctly on ZFS can significantly cut down on write amplification, and may result in more performance as your drive's effectively doing less work than it would otherwise have to do. One thing I do want to note, if you want to play around with your system and you have different hardware, it might be a good idea to set up a configuration like this, where you have multiple SSDs, one VM that's writing a mirror to multiple ones to see how the write amplification changes. I put all the scripts I used and the Jupyter notebook I used for all the data analysis in the description if you want to take a look for it and run it yourself. Or what you can do is even just do a simple write test on your VM, take a look at something like IOSTAT that shows your current amount of writes, and compare that to what the host shows to see if your host device is getting significantly more writes than your VM's reported internal virtual disk it's writing to. I also just want to point out, for server use, especially where you're running multiple VMs that are likely going to do a good amount of writes anyways, I recommend going with server grade drives instead of consumer grade drives, if at all possible, no matter what your settings are, as they generally just handle write-heavy workloads much better than consumer-grade drives do. Thanks for watching this video looking into ZFS write amplification. Is this an issue you're worried about? Have you tried tuning any of these settings or seen ZFS write amplification? Did I miss a setting that might affect write amplification? I'm curious to hear what your thoughts are in the comments below. I've also set up memberships for this channel, giving you access to videos like these a little bit early when I can get around to it, and some behind-the-scenes videos. Check out the join button below if that's something that interests you.